Hello, everybody. Welcome back to another session on entrepreneurship. So today we have Raja. So a lot of people would know him. So Raja is in founder of Eat Raja and mostly Radio Jockey. So thank you, Raja, for being here. It's a pleasure to have you. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Lakshit. So it's amazing to be on a show with you. And I'm excited about talking about my social enterprise, Eat Raja.
Yeah, it's my pleasure to have you. Yeah, so first question is if you can speak about yourself and what you do, that would be amazing.
Lakshit, basically, so I'm born, brought up, spoiled all in Bangalore. I did all my studies here in Bangalore. I did my engineering in biomedical at BMS College. Mm-hmm. And after that, like how every Bangalorean would do, I wanted to work for a software company, maybe earn a lot of money and then go off to the US. So that's like the set path for every Bangalorean here, at least the ones who do engineering. Okay? So since my seniors, my friends were all doing the same, you know, study engineering, then take up your GRE, go abroad and get settled there or maybe look for a job, things like that. So I was almost decided on that during my engineering days, but luck had it totally different way. After I finished my engineering, like everybody else, I just got into, you know, data warehousing, ERP implementation and whatnot. And I did work for a biomedical engineering company too for some time.
Okay.
And after that, after like 2-3 years of just, you know, working in IT field and biomedical and all of that, luck came calling through radio. So
yeah.
I got my job in Radio Mirchi. Mm-hmm. It was a very new thing those days, FM radio in Bangalore. As in, not very new, but people knew about only one radio station. Then after Radio Mirchi came, there was like the second phase of radio. Lots of people actually got to know about radio. Okay. And that's where my career started and I became a radio jockey. After okay. that, there was no looking back at all. So I was there on radio for 13 long years.
Okay.
And during this time, I only did filmy interviews, everything around. It was all masti, dhamal and all those kind of things. So it was a... I worked with actually three different radio stations in this 13 years. The first one was with Radio Mirchi and after that with Red FM 93.5. And after that, another international radio station. So during my third stint with radio is when my father passed away. And after which he used to run a juice center in Malleshwaram, Bangalore.
Yeah.
And I said, okay, fine. I had no other choice but to take over that because there was nobody else to take care of it.
Yeah.
So then my mom said, like, okay, I will handle the juice center. You continue with your radio. And that's how it happened for some time. Then I figured out that, you know, she was finding it very difficult to run the juice center. And as she's never done any business before. So I said, okay, fine. Let me quit radio and help her. And at that time, you know, in Bangalore, everybody wants to be an entrepreneur. Actually, the new cool thing is to be an entrepreneur.
Yeah.
And do something on your own. And especially if you are a techie, 90% of them have this dream of having their own restaurant or food business venture or something similar to that.
Yeah.
Since I already had something which my dad had done for me, a juice center, I said, like, why don't I experiment with this? Then I started helping my mom with this.
Okay.
Right from my college days, I was always into eco-friendly activities, be it, you know, planting trees or keeping the forest clean or doing something with the lakes. I always used to do that. So then I realized that, you know, my juice center was generating a lot of waste in terms of single-use plastic, maybe cup, straws, and, you know, parcel the juices, you have to give them a bag and all that. So I said, okay, this is criminal. I don't think this should be happening. And that's when I figured out that this was crime, and I stopped everything at once.
Okay.
My mom panicked, and she said, like, oh, what the hell are you doing, man? We were selling water bottles also, of which we get decent money. But I said, I don't want to make money out of selling plastic. So we decided that, you know, we will not do anything that's got to do with plastic. And we banned everything in 2018 March, if I remember precisely. That's when we started Eat Raja. Eat Raja is a name that I coined after my dad. Because my dad used to use those terms very often.
Okay.
Eat Raja. So in his memory, okay. I got this thing going. And after that, we banned everything. But then I also was like working on a lot of you know, conservative things. And then I figured out that, you know, every glass that we use to wash has about 250 ml of juice. But to wash it, we spend more water.
Yeah.
So I said, like, okay, that's criminal. We are having only 250 ml of juice, but to wash it because we need it really clean and, you know, very nice and sparkling glass, right? For that, we spend a lot of water. We waste a lot of water in keeping it clean. And I said, like, okay, this is genuinely a waste of virgin water.
Yeah.
And that's when, during summer, is when we get this variety of watermelon called Kiran, which is like slightly smaller than the normal big watermelon that
you get.
I said, like, hey, this looks like a cup, so why don't I cut this into two and make two cups and serve juices inside of that?
Yeah.
And once I started doing that, I figured out that, you know, it's got like quite a funny thing and it's very Instagram worthy too.
Yeah.
Initially, people didn't like it. They said, like, what the hell is this? Why are you giving us juices in a fruit shell? Don't you have disposable cups? Don't you have glass jars? So I said, no, this is how I will give juices. If you want, you can have. Otherwise, sorry about it. So that way, I started giving out juices only in watermelon shells initially. Some of them liked it. Some of them didn't like it. And those who liked it took pictures and they put it on Instagram. And slowly, you know, people started identifying that, hey, this juice center is a little different.
Yeah.
Trying some crazy stuff. And slowly people started coming. Then I didn't stop at just watermelon because after a few watermelons, I got bored. I was like, what do we do next? So I said, okay, great. Let's try something different. And then I looked at muskmelon. I took the muskmelon. I made that into a cup and I started serving. And dekhte, bahut saare aise fruits aa gaye. Jo bhi fruits milta tha, usko main cup bana ke, usi mein se juice dal ke, main sabko serve karta. Okay. And it became quite a, you know, interesting thing, especially on Instagram.
Yeah,
because people love to post pictures of how they have been spending their day and having some crazy stuff and all. A lot of food bloggers and all, they came down and they started taking pictures and it became quite a rage actually. Then I figured out that people are really enjoying juices and they're not coming just to have some juice, but they're coming for an experience. And that last July, that is 2019 July is when I think I said, okay, everybody is selling sweet juices. So why don't I try doing something different? Because normal is boring. Then that was the season of guavas. So I looked at the guava and I was like, okay, let's start serving juices in guava. Guava is so small.
Yeah.
So I picked up bigger size guavas and scooped up the fruit and I started making juices with chili and guava. And I called it chili guava and I started serving with that with a dash of, you know, salt and chili powder. It turned amazing. And even till date, I think this is the fastest selling and the most demanded juice, the chili guava shots.
Yeah.
And then on, there has never been a looking back. I kept experimenting. I think I've done almost all fruits that are available here in Bangalore.
Okay.
That way, I became India's first zero waste juice bar because we completely don't use any paper cup, any plastic cup, no straws. We don't even offer tissues. And definitely, there are no glasses used. So, it's only the fruit shell. So, if you want to have avocado, it will be served in avocado. If you want to have carrot, it will be served in carrot. Pineapple in pineapple. Apple in apple. Watermelon in watermelon. Muskmelon in muskmelon. And that way, we have like about 70 to 80 different varieties.
Okay, wonderful. Yeah, so yeah, I have also tasted one of your juices. I don't remember the name, but I have already tasted, I think, in the muskmelon shell. So, yeah.
When was it that you had come down?
I think I came in month of Feb. I think that was, I don't remember really. Possibly in month of Jan or Feb.
This year?
Yeah.
Yeah, if it was this year, you would have come when it was really, really crowded. We had like super crowd, as in a lot of people coming in until about March 22nd. And after the Janta curfew, slowly, you know, people had this corona fear and we also shut shop and we have reopened really like last week.
Yeah.
So we are still expecting crowds to.
True. And what was the major thing? Why do you think, how did you get the attention by people and, you know, different kind of news people and a lot of different kind of things? How did you get attention?
See, what happens is you have visited my shop, right? So my shop is bang on the main road and it's between two very famous temples and it's normally super crowded. Yeah. So normally there is always a crowd outside the temple because people are either getting into the temple or there is some prasad being given, and there's normally a crowd outside the temple.
Yeah.
And in between two temples, there's a small, barely seen shop which is also having some kind of a crowd. So people started wondering, like, is this a new temple or something? Then they figured out it's not a temple, because normally, you know, when people come to have juices, they were in queue and they were like fighting to get a fruit cup, and they were like, it was quite a bit crowded actually. So people are wondering, what's happening here? Why are people going back? What is this? They're coming back with a fruit shell, and water is being served there. Out of curiosity, a lot of people on onlookers came and looked at it and like, oh, this is cool, okay, fine. This, and then slowly local media started covering me in all the newspapers. By then a few of them got to know, and then excellent word of mouth publicity, and I can't thank enough Instagram, social media, Twitter, Facebook, all of these things, YouTube, everywhere the videos started doing viral rounds. And what was the beauty of it was every time a channel covers it, it used to go viral. And I used to see like a huge crowd outside my shop. I thought once, twice, I felt, okay, it happened, it's over. I think it's the end of it. It did not stop even until March. So we started in July until March. Everybody who came covered it, those videos went viral, and I got a lot of attention, a lot of love from media and from people. People from all over the world started coming in. People from the United Nations came down. Some film stars came down. So, it was a crazy time that we had.
Okay. And before starting the juice, you know, I like, it would be hard, right? Because when you start, you don't know, like, how it would turn, how would you remove the pulp of the soup. So, what were the difficulties before, you know, starting this food, fruit shell thing?
So, I have, to be honest, so I did my engineering, and after that I was in radio, and my dad never really wanted me to run a juice shop, because he thought that because he was not educated, he studied only till 10th standard. He made sure that me and my brother become engineers, and he said that, you know, my son has to be a software engineer. So that's what every parent dreams here in Bangalore to say so.
Yeah.
So even he thought the same, and then never really thought that I should be working in a juice center. So after my dad passed away, I had no clue how to make juice.
Yeah.
So I didn't know how to make juice. It's very unbelievable sometimes that, you know, a guy who did not know how to make even a juice now is running a very famous juice bar.
Yeah.
It's almost like, you know, impossible. I can't believe myself sometimes. Because many of the times I didn't even know which fruit. Some of the fruits, I'm seeing it for the first time. Like just last week, I found a new fruit that is mango steam. I've never seen a fruit like that, nor have I tasted. Okay. And I've started making juices out of it, shots out of it. People have liked it. So I've been on a discovery mode ever since my dad passed away. So I've been learning new things every single day. The challenges were that, you know, I didn't know what should I do with this fruit. I mean, should I make a juice out of it or not? Should I add sugar or salt? Is it a sweet juice or is it a spicy juice?
Yeah.
Many, many times I had questions with my own self. I had nobody to ask to as to how does one go about doing what. So I Googled a lot of info, and then on YouTube I used to watch a couple of videos. And finally I found, like, you know, experimentation is the best way to find what you're doing.
Yeah.
Every day I used to make juices with varieties, and then I found that they were really good. Whatever worked, I said, okay, fine, let's go with this. And I used to put the juice out on the board. And that way, we started inventing a lot of variety of juices here. Like muskmelon and mango are juices normally not sold anywhere. I said that I have to be different because I'm an engineer. So it can't just be another juice center. I didn't want to be one amongst a whole lot. So I said, okay, fine, let's do this. So I started introducing juices like cigarette juice, and then, you know, Super 30 juice. So I used to trend with what was happening. Like the cigarette juice was not even a juice that was there. So basically my idea was that if you are a smoker and if you want to give up smoking, you can come over and drop that cigarette and I will give you a juice for free. Probably a juice that can fight cancer, like pineapple and beetroot and carrot. Mixed together, these are like amazing juices that fight cancerous cells, the spread of cancerous cells. So these kind of juices I started. I also a lot of gimmick juices were being sold around that time. So people started wondering, okay, what is this Super 30 juice? And when Super 30 released, I figured out that, you know, Indians are known to be great mathematicians. But unfortunately, many of us, for everything, you need a calculator. We just pick up the mobile and check. Even I do sometimes.
Yeah.
So I said, okay, fine, let's get some mathematics out of people. So Super 30 was all about mathematics. So I said, okay, let's do this. I say, I'll give you 30 seconds. If you can solve this mathematical puzzle, this juice is free. That's how I started Super 30 Juice, and then it was also fun. And then later on, during our Kannada Rajyotsava, I said, like, for non-Kannadigas, if you can come up with some words in Kannada, then you get a juice free. So there were many, many attractive offers. So many people never really came to my shop just to have juices. So there were really different concepts that people really liked. Like, bring your own bottle, you get a juice free, or many, many things like that. Like right now, I'm having this bring your own bottle, and I'm offering free watermelon juices. So yeah, that way a lot of concepts I started putting in there, and people started liking.
Okay, and coming, your idea is unique. You know, as you said, you serve the fruit in like the juice in the nutshell. So why did you think not to make it expensive, and why the prices are, you know, like, fine, you know, it's not much expensive, not so less. What was the reason to, you know, keep it not that expensive? Yeah.
So I figured out, see, I have gone and see, not to take the names of my contemporaries who are giving organic, fresh, nice, sugarless juices. I found that they were so unaffordable for a common man. Like a bottle of juice would be like some 150, 140, just because their presentation is in a really good bottle, and maybe they have some nice stickering around. So the classy presentation. So I said, why should this be only for the privileged few who are earning a lot of money? Why can't it be affordable to a lot of them? So then also my shop is located in an area called Malleshwaram, which is like a very, I would say it's a cultural capital of Bangalore. People are very down to earth over there, and you can't really keep anything for that reason sky high, because people are very articulate, they're very well read, so they will question you for why is it so expensive.
True.
So I said to myself that, okay, let's bring a juice that is really affordable, especially there are lots of colleges around my juice shop as well. I said, let's make it really affordable. And what I always felt was that I was never selling juices, I was selling only an experience. And I believed in that, like, if somebody were to come and just have a juice and think of me, maybe even 20 years later, that would be really great. And for me, there was no need that I had to generate my income only with this juice center.
Okay.
So I had alternate source of income, as in I was a radio jockey, so I used to get a lot of events to host. So I was making my money from there. So it was not really difficult for me to make money, but this juice center was something that I felt should be like a place where people come for an experience. And I really wanted them to sample this out and see how there can be a shop without plastic.
Okay. Yeah. So, and now the question, like, what are the, you know, the bad side? You know, everybody knows that if you become an entrepreneur, you make your own money, you earn your own money, you earn good money. So what do you think, what's the dark side of being an entrepreneur?
The dark side of being an entrepreneur is the initial days, the struggle days. Those are the days that actually can break you down.
Yeah.
Okay. So what happens is when you start off with a concept like this, that I won't give you any juices in a cup, I will only give it to you in a fruit cup, the acceptance level for something new is not immediate. So people don't really like any change like that. There were many people like, okay, I don't want to have, I don't know if it's clean or not. I don't know why you're giving me this. Is it safe? Is it healthy? So I feel that, you know, entrepreneurs should really have a strong gut feel and not let go of their dreams. Okay. If you pass that phase where those are the most difficult days, actually. So those are the days when nobody, I still remember, last year around the same time, June, it rains over here. We don't have customers, and a lot of people don't come at all to drink juices, especially when it rains.
Yeah.
But then I kept on with my juices. I started putting out posts, innovative posts, a lot of innovative juices. And I just went on with the flow, like whether people come or not, I will never give up. And I kept on reinventing juices, putting up new menu juices, and lots of things like that. I was maybe personally enjoying it also every day. So it never really stopped me. But it used to bother me at the end of the day when I look at the cash box that, you know, we haven't made good business. So if you can pass through this phase when nobody is willing to believe your idea, but you don't give up, then ultimately when you see success is like the biggest thing. So going through that phase when nobody is supporting you and to stay strong is the toughest thing and the great challenge for anyone. Because it's very easy to give up during those phases. Like, you know, and I have seen so many stories from so many entrepreneurs. Nobody has become an entrepreneur like day one, they do something and everybody is satisfied, right? They have all had to go through the grind. So everybody has to go through the grind, and that's the only way to learn and correct your mistakes as well.
Okay. So coming to the question, as we know today, as we are in a digital era, every day there is a new trend. Every day people are changing. Every day things are changing. So how do you think you would be, you know, after 5 years, how would you be able to keep that same trend? How would you make it in a different way and stand out in everybody's eyes as a shop, as a company, as Eat Raja?
5 years is too long a time, bro. Actually, I am already thinking, okay, it's already getting boring. So we need to reinvent and we need to do a lot of new things. So like I said, when I started last April with just watermelon, in about a week's time or so, I got bored. How many times will I just keep only making watermelon? Then I progressed to muskmelon. Then I progressed to pomegranates, then carrots, then apples and peach. So until last week, I've covered almost like, I think, some 60 to 70 fruits and vegetables right now. So I still feel that, okay, now what next? Now the rainy season is here. There is no crowd. And also after Corona, people are literally scared to come out and even eat or shop or do anything. So I have to make my place even more attractive. So I thought that it's really hot. And I mean, I personally felt, maybe I think I should have some nice hot chocolate sandwich or something like that. I said, okay, great. Why don't I make hot the chocolate sandwich with fruits inside that, and let's try it out and see. So like that, maybe I will start doing that. So every now and then there has to be innovation. I feel we already have had a good response from people now. So the only big thing that we're going to do is expand. We already have taken places at different colleges and some IT parks and some prime locations in Bangalore where we are going to be expanding into. And of course, I've got like lots of inquiries from all over India and across the globe to give them franchises. So that's the next thing. So in the next 1 year, you will see a lot of Eat Raja being rolled out in different cities. And I'm really looking forward for that.
Okay, wonderful. Like, what would be an advice by your side to anybody who wants to start their own company and become an entrepreneur?
My advice, like I said, initially, it's going to be very difficult because nobody is going to buy your idea. Everybody wants to only, either say it's not nice, and then you will not get initially a lot of support. So if you think that your idea is really awesome and you really think that it's going to work, just stick to it, believe in yourself and go ahead and do it. But innovation, marketing, all of it is very, very important. You can't have a dud product and then say, hey, please come and buy it, unless there's something really interesting about it. So if you look at my own product, it's the same juice that everybody's been selling. I think lakhs and lakhs of people in India have juice centers, but the way how they have been selling probably is different. So that's where I think I made the difference. I said, like, you can't imagine possibly any juice center not to serve juices without a cup. So I said, okay, let's break the monotony. And then I said, okay, I'll start serving in fruit juices, in fruit shells. That became a new trend. And so I think that was very innovative.
Okay.
So innovation definitely works. Something that is new and hatke, where people think that, oh, this is really nice. And also these days, social media is everything. So if your product sells on social media, like how they say, you're big tie. Because many people who have still not come to my shop are friends with me on Instagram, and they keep telling me, wow, this is great, that's nice. A lot of following is there on that, because see, they haven't really consumed the juices, but they are aware, they're seeing those juices being consumed by a lot of people, and the photographs are all there on Instagram. And I think that really works. Is what I feel.
Okay, so yeah, last question to you is what would be a special message or any kind of message you would like to give to the audience or to any kind of message you would like to leave here?
So I feel that, you know, we all dream about doing things, but there is only a small percentage of people who actually put in the effort to do what they thought that they should be doing.
Yeah.
In many cases, like Eat Raja was my idea 3 years ago when I was still a radio jockey and my dad was alive. I did pitch this idea to my dad and I said, like, okay, can we do something different at your juice center? He said, like, please don't touch my juice business. You're good at doing what you're doing behind the radio. Just do that. Don't try hanky-panky stuff. So I just kept quiet. So a lot of us like this have ideas. Maybe there's nobody to support us, nobody to, you know, encourage us. So if anybody thinks that they have a great idea and it's going to be a potential game changer, they should just go give it a try. Come what may, just give it a try. Because until you try, you never know how successful it could be. If it was not successful, you can always get back to what you were doing or maybe try something else. But at least you have a reason that I tried what I wanted to.
Yeah.
Maybe it didn't work, so I'll try something else.
Yeah.
But if it worked, like how in my case it's worked, it's amazing.
Yeah.
And like you feel really happy about what you thought and finally you gave wings to your dreams. And I feel very, very happy and very proud that I was able to do it and pull it off. Not everybody is lucky enough to do what they really like to do and get other people to like it. So that way I consider myself lucky.
Okay, so yeah, wonderful. Thank you very much for being here. It was my pleasure to have you. It was a wonderful session. And hope you have a good days. Hope this corona thing gets over fast. You know, all the businesses and whatever your ideas are there, they come over and get better. So yeah, good wishes to you. Thank you very much for being here.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. And all the very best to you. You are a young, influential person. So
thank you very much.
I'm sure you have a lot of fan following. So whoever is following you, thank you so much for listening to me. Do drop by Eat Raja in Malleshwaram Bank.